physics of other forces, other things in a curved background, in a curved background space. But we haven't yet understood what action sets the dynamics for the gravitational field itself, for the metric tensor itself. Okay, that's what we're going to discuss now. Okay, so in order to do this, what we need is some expression built out of the metric field and its derivatives that is generally coordinate and that is general covariant. So we can add this expression to the action and generate the equations of motion for action. Okay, how are we going to make an expression for in terms of the metric field and its derivatives that is generally covariant? Well, what am I going to do is to appeal to geometry. Okay, to help us make such expressions. Okay, so remember that we had this notion of parallel transport. We had this equation that delta A mu was equal to gamma mu, say alpha, theta A theta dx alpha. You remember that a small change in a one form when we parallelly transported from x to x plus dx was given by this formula. Now you can ask the following question. Suppose I take this little one-form field and transport it in a little loop so that you come back to yourself. Does this process of parallel transport bring the vector back to itself? Or is there a change? If there's a change, what is the change? Okay, so the answer is going to be, in general, it won't bring it back to itself. There will be a change, and we want to compute what it is. Okay, so now, let's suppose that the size of this loop that we're looking at is of order epsilon. Okay, we're looking at a loop whose length scale is of order epsilon. We're going to do our calculation. To the first non-trivial order, the first place where we see an effect. And that first non-trivial order is turns out to be at order epsilon squared. Okay? So we're going to do this calculation of this change, take this vector around a little loop, bring it back to itself. The loop size is order epsilon. At order epsilon squared, we'll see that we don't come back exactly to ourselves, but something else. And we're going to compute what that effect is. Now, how do we do this? So we've got a differential equation, tells us how A changes as we go around a little infinitesimal. We have to integrate this differential equation, come back to ourselves, along the path that comes back to ourselves, and that gives us the answer. There's a formal solution to such differential equations in terms of path-ordered exponentials, if you want to do it in some exact way. But such complicated things are not for us at the moment. We can just work simply because we're working toward epsilon squared. So, you see, as we start at a point, and we've got a little loop. Now, A, let's say that at this first point, at the starting point, A mu is equal to A mu 0. Let's say we're starting at the point 0 for convenience. Okay. Now, A changes as we move along this path. But this integral here, as an integral over the length of the path, that integral, this integrated dx, will give you a factor of epsilon. Okay, so the if we're interested in changes in A at order epsilon square, we only need to worry about, I mean, the change in A as we come around the path at order epsilon square. On the right hand side of this expression, we only need to correctly input the value of A corrected at order epsilon. Is this clear? Okay? So, the first thing to remember is that we can't just do this integral, you know, treating A as a constant. Because A changes along the path by this expression. A is A0 here, but something else here, something else here, something else there. So, in order to compute this change along this path, we're going to need what A is along the path. But the great way of working in this order by order way is that we only need to know what A is at order epsilon to get the change right at order epsilon square. Is this clear? So firstly, let's first compute A at order epsilon. Well, So we use the same recursive logic. To get A at order epsilon, we only need to input A at order 0 into this expression. Okay? So at order, so let's suppose that A mu is equal to A mu 0 plus epsilon times A mu 1 plus epsilon square times. We want to know what A mu 1 is. Well, A mu 1 obeys the equation del, so A mu 1 is equal to gamma mu alpha theta at 0. So if we take, you know, the Taylor expansion of gamma, the first term in the Taylor expansion is at order epsilon. Okay, so to compute A mu 1, that's an overkill because we're already doing an integral, which is another order epsilon. Okay, gamma mu theta alpha A mu at 0 times A theta at 0 dx alpha. Since these are both constants, the solution is obvious. The solution is A mu 1 is equal to gamma mu alpha theta of 0 A theta 0 times x alpha. Okay? So, we have A mu is equal to A mu of 0 plus gamma mu alpha theta of 0 A theta 0 x alpha plus blah blah blah. Okay, this is order 0, this is order, I mean epsilon to the 0, this is order epsilon to the 1, everything higher will be epsilon to the 2.
Epsilon.
Epsilon was a formal parameter. You can in the end set epsilon to 1. It's just order counting parameter. Epsilon's there just for you to keep. Epsilon's in your head. Okay. It's x or delta x that carries the power. Okay, now, in order to get this right to quadratic order, we also need gamma correct to order epsilon. So once again, we will get, that is simple, that we just Taylor expand. Okay, so gamma mu alpha theta is equal to gamma mu alpha theta, this is at x, this is also at x. Okay, alpha theta, let's call it del phi. X phi, sorry, first the 0th piece, plus del phi gamma mu alpha theta. All derivatives evaluated at 0. Okay. I'm not going to indicate that explicitly. It just makes it too cumbersome. Times x phi, plus higher order things that are order epsilon square. So we don't need those. Now all we have to do is take this and plug in. So let's do that. So at order epsilon square, we get that delta A mu is equal to, well, first we should ask what happens at order epsilon. Okay. So at order epsilon, well, it's just A1 at 0 minus A1 at 0, which is 0, because this is, you know, nice solution. Path-independent solution, so you just get 0. Yeah. What I'm saying is that the integral of x dx over any closed curve is 0. Obvious. Okay, so at order epsilon, there's no change. So the first change is at order epsilon square. Okay, so what's the change at order epsilon square? Well, we plug this in, so we get one term is this term, so del phi of gamma mu alpha theta A theta x phi d x alpha. Okay, and the second term is in putting A1 here. Okay, so plus gamma mu alpha theta. Now, then we want to put this with mu replaced by theta. So gamma theta, we'll use something else for alpha, let's call it beta. And we'll use something else for theta, let's call it zeta. Now we have to remember, does a cheat sheet, mu went to theta, alpha went to beta, and theta went to zeta. This was an a theta, so according to a cheat sheet, that becomes a zeta. And this was an x alpha, according to this, that was a beta. Okay, that became the x beta. What? And yes, dx alpha. Okay, now, while it's obviously true that the integral over a closed path of dx alpha is 0, as we got for the first order variation of A, is it true that the integral of x dx with lots of indices thrown in is always 0? No, it's not. Hey, this observation was made by many people, I'm sure, but you know, it's essentially the observation of Stokes. It's this, you know, Stokes' theorem that tells you how you can take a vector field and what you get if you integrate it over a closed path. The answer is that it's the integral over of the curl of the vector field over the area. We will say this in a slightly better way in just a moment. Okay? Now, at first order, we got 0 because the vector field was a constant. So its curl was 0. Its derivative was 0. Okay? At second order, we don't get 0 because the vector field is proportional to x. So its curl is not 0. The curl is constant, but it's not 0. Okay? So all we have to do is to look at, to use Stokes' theorem on this answer. Okay. So in order to do that, let's rewrite this thing with the indices a little different. Okay, so both of these have dx alpha, dx with a dummy variable alpha, but in this case the dummy variable for x was beta, while in this case it was phi. And here we don't have a phi, so we'll just replace beta by phi. Okay? So now we want to apply Stokes' theorem. So let me remind you what Stokes' theorem says. Stokes' theorem says that if you've got an some integral like this, m alpha dx alpha over a closed loop, this is equal to the integral of del theta m alpha minus del alpha n theta dx theta dx alpha minus dx alpha dx theta divided by 2. What does this mean? You've got a little area element. You break it up into little boxes. The sides of the boxes are the two vectors, dx1 and dx2. And you take this parallelepiped form from these two little vectors to make up this element. Okay, and sum over all little boxes. Contract that with this, sum over all little boxes. Okay? This is, if you rewrite it in the way you're more familiar with, it's curl dot normal. Okay? Because the curl has an epsilon, is this with an epsilon, and then taking that epsilon on this makes it the normal vector. Okay? But this is a better way to write Stokes' theorem because it generalizes beyond three dimensions. It generalizes beyond. It's the natural way of writing the theorem. This is the wedge product notation for, this is the integral of a form, for those of you who know what that means. We'll know what it means by the end of this course. Okay. Fine. So, now we're going to apply this. This by 2 is because there are two terms here. So when you get when you dualize to the normal, you'll become twice normal and cancel the by 2. Okay. Fine. So now we're going to use this theorem here. We're going to use this theorem. We just have to identify what M alpha is. Well, so let's see. There are many indices around here. But most of them go along for the ride. Like this mu index, as far as Stokes' theorem is concerned, is going along for the ride. See, what's important is that on the right-hand side here, we've got an alpha index contracted with dx alpha. Whatever that is, whatever else that is, there is on that alpha index, there will be some index indices dressing these m, and those indices will just go along for the ride. Is this clear? Please. Yes.
So if you do it for two dimensions, dx dy minus dy.
This is really dx theta 1 dx alpha 2 minus dx alpha 2 dx 1 1 and 2. We've got these two little vectors here. Okay, this is vector 1, this is vector 2. It's the area element along this little parallelogram. Sorry, I should. Okay, excellent. That was a good question. Okay. So, this, by the way, this is what Landau-Lipschitz refers to as F12. It's the volume form on the hypercells. Okay, so when you see F12 written in Landau-Lipschitz, this is what it means. Or F alpha beta on a surface, this is what it means. Okay, fine. Now, what we want to do is to compute this guy. So what is M alpha for us? Just all the other indices go along for the ride, but the alpha index was alpha there. Okay? We want to take the derivative with respect to theta. So let me write this as phi. So that the indices match. Yeah? The derivative of an expression linear in x just drops the x. Okay? So, this m alpha, del phi m alpha, is simply this where we dropped the x. Okay? So, in our context, this del phi m alpha minus del alpha m phi is simply del phi of gamma mu alpha theta a theta. By where I write a theta, say 0 theta, of course. Okay? Plus gamma theta mu alpha gamma theta zeta phi. Is it? Okay? And then according to Stokes' theorem, I'm supposed to subtract out this part. So I'm supposed to subtract out phi going to alpha minus del alpha gamma mu phi theta a theta minus gamma mu theta phi gamma theta alpha zeta is it. Okay, so the answer. Please.
That m alpha dx alpha.
Yes.
We are matching with this thing, right?
Yes.
Okay. Then we are going to write the term for del phi m alpha minus del alpha m phi.
Exactly.
So, but here this phi thing is being contracted already.
It's contracted with an x. Okay. With x phi. So now take derivative of this with respect to phi.
Okay. Then
it just kills that. Clear? Okay. Fine. Now, this expression, this is our final answer. This integrated over the area. Okay? And this expression here, has a name, so we'll now get the conventions the same way. It's called the curvature, or let me say it more precisely. I'm going to give you a definition now. So let's define R I K L M to be del L gamma I K M minus del M gamma I K L plus gamma I N L gamma N K M minus gamma I N M gamma N K L. Okay. Then with this definition, if we've done everything right, it should be that delta A is A, okay, K. And I'll write what Landau-Lipschitz says and then we'll check if we've got the same answer. Half R I K L M F L M by 2. Oh, the half is the by 2. Okay. So let's see. Oh, and where's the A? Sorry, there's the AI. Okay. Let's check if that's working. So, firstly, this I index should be this I index here. So that's this theta index here. Wait, something's... Oh, and then there's L here. Okay. Okay, let's check that this is right. Okay, let's do it properly. So, let's see. So, let me first write this guy in that form, and then we'll... Okay, so what do we have? Our conclusion was... So this is Landau-Lipschitz. Okay, what did we conclude from here? We concluded that... delta A, we were doing delta A mu, right? Yeah. Well, we concluded that delta A mu was equal to, okay, now, del phi gamma, now, so what we should do is every time we have an A, we should contract with the same index. That was going to kill us. So this there was a theta here and there was a zeta here. Zeta is not used here. So let's make thetas zetas. Okay. Zeta, 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 zeta. Okay. So now we'll write zeta and so now all the indices are good. So let's write this as mu alpha plus, and write this, minus del alpha gamma zeta mu phi plus gamma theta mu alpha gamma zeta theta phi minus gamma theta mu phi gamma zeta theta alpha a zeta by 2 f we had our phi alpha. Okay, so phi alpha should be Lm. So I'm just going to replace in Landau-Lipschitz things L and M by phi and alpha. Phi alpha, phi alpha, sorry people. Lm, phi alpha, now which is an L and which is an I? Upper is I. Yes. Okay. Phi alpha phi alpha, and then I should replace I and K if I want to compare here with zeta and mu. So I and K is zeta and mu. Zeta K is mu, I is zeta, K is mu, I is zeta, K is mu, I is zeta, K is mu. Okay, and if we've done everything right, this should just match this now. Del phi mu alpha minus del alpha gamma zeta mu phi plus the theta is something, is n. That's okay. Yeah, it's fine. Right? Okay, we've written. Okay, so we have the same expression as Landau-Lipschitz. So victory. Okay, so what have we concluded? We've concluded that the change in this one form as we go around this little loop is given by this expression where this object here is what's called the curvature tense. Okay? So one of the things we've learned is that parallel transport cannot be unambiguously used in general to define a vector field or a one-form field from a given vector at a point. You know, suppose I've got a given vector at one point or given one form at one point. Now, I try to say, let me define a field by parallelly transporting this vector to every other point in space. That process is ambiguous. It depends on what path you use for the parallel transport. In general, because different paths give you different answers, as we've just seen. Okay? So parallel transport is less universal than you might have thought. It depends, it's path dependent. Okay. Now, the fact that there is curvature also tells you that covariant derivatives don't commute. Oh, so something I should say, by the way, is that this curvature here is obviously a tensor. Why is it a tensor? It's because this object, being just the byproduct of two infinitesimals, is obviously a tensor with upper indices. And curvature and delta ik is the difference between two vectors at or two one-forms at the same point. So that transforms like a one-form. Only way that can work is that this transforms like a tensor with all its indices, you know, with its indices indicated. Okay? Curvature is built out of gammas. Gammas contain derivatives of the metric field. So we've succeeded in identifying a tensor that is built out of derivatives of the metric field. Okay, so we succeeded in our task, and we're going to use this R to build Einstein's action, to build the action for the gravitational field. But before we actually do that, there's some more gymnastics I'm going to do. Yes.
So, is there a point considering the higher order terms in delta?
Yes. Okay. Now that can be iterated. If you want to get the whole answer, it can be written as a local expression, meaning. The answer is complicated, but all the information is there in local curvatures. You see, it's like an integral. Okay, suppose you want to know how much something changes from here to here. Okay, if you know how much it changes over an infinitesimal little bit, then you just add it up and you get the answer. It's the same thing here. What we've determined is how much something changes over a little area element. Now you want the change in a big loop. You just add up the changes over the little area elements. The only complicated thing is that you're going to have to use the appropriate value of A.
It doesn't matter with what sort of area it is, because a loop can be enclosed by area itself.
Yeah. It doesn't matter when you use the appropriate value of A. Okay, so let's address this question in a little more detail. Suppose you actually wanted to compute what you would get over a big path. What you would actually do is what you would actually do is take that original differential equation we wrote down and try to solve it. So the original differential equation was delta A mu is equal to gamma alpha mu phi dx alpha. Okay, so one way of proceeding is to take this and just solve it along the path. Solve that differential equation along the path. But now we could apply Stokes' theorem. You see, this thing here also has the form integral of a one form along a path. So we could apply Stokes' theorem to this whole thing here. Okay? And the complicated thing there is knowing what to put in the middle. Because you're going to have to find a field, an A field. Gamma, of course, is defined everywhere. But A is not defined everywhere. You see, A was just defined at a point. So what you're going to have to do is to find an A field that has the correct values on the boundary. And the values on the boundary are determined by this differential equation. Once you do that, having done that, what you'll get is the same expression, you know, locally done, but with a local value of this A. Do you understand what I mean? So suppose I've got some A field, whatever it is. You find an A field that agrees with the values on the boundary. Agrees with the value that you would get by solving this differential equation on the boundary. Suppose you have any A field that does that.
Shouldn't that be unique?
What?
Shouldn't that A field be unique if
you're R extremely? Yes, the A field is unique. Sorry. No. The boundary is unique. The filling up is up to you, I think.
But then won't it change the R, right? For different choices of A?
No, it won't change R. R is a geometric quantity. Yeah. We've got R. What you will have to argue is that all these ambiguities drop out of the final answer. Okay, but just one way of doing it. Just one way in which would already tell you something important. So let me say it. One way of doing it is find an A field that fills up the surface, agrees with the right values of the boundary. Okay? And then with that A field, we just apply Stokes' theorem. Okay? So we would get this with an integral as a as a finite expression. I think. I'm going to have to think about this. I'm going to let me think about this and give you a better answer. Okay. One thing that I do want to claim though is that if R is zero, okay, then this will be zero even for finite parts. This is obvious, right? Because for any little bit, it's zero, and so it adds up to zero. To get the actual answer will be complicated. But your question is, will it identify new geometric invariants? I don't think so. It'll just be in terms of R and maybe derivatives of R. R as a local field. Yeah. Okay, good question. I'll give you a better answer to that question. By next. Okay, excellent. Fine. So, we've succeeded in our program of... we've succeeded in our program of... we've succeeded in our program of trying to you know, the question. Oh, yeah, we'll talk about your question.
So, why is the definition of R? It already gives you like dr is equal to zero, since it's defined as a d of something. Is this
d of something meaning what?
I mean, exterior derivative of something.
No, it's not an exterior.
R is not an exterior.
You know, exterior derivative applies only to forms, only to objects with completely anti-symmetric indices.
Okay.
This is not something of... No, so it's not an exterior.
I'm basically asking, does this definition of R already give you an equation,
motion,
like in the case of...
Yes, there is a Bianchi identity, okay, which we will come to. Yes. Yes, yes. There's a sense in which you're right that it's an exterior derivative. We'll come to this in this class, hopefully. Okay, excellent. Fine. So this has already given us a quantity that is built out of derivatives of R, that out of derivatives of the metric that we can use to build Einstein's actions, and we will. But before we do that, there are a few more algebraic gymnastics that we want to do in order to identify more clearly what role this R plays. Okay. Now, the next question I'm going to ask is, suppose we've done this exercise with a vector field rather than a one-form field. Okay? What would our answer have been? Okay? Now, if you remember when we started discussing parallel transport of vectors, we deduced how a vector would be parallel transport in terms of the definition of how a one-form must be parallel transported, just from the observation that a scalar receives no parallel transport. It doesn't change under parallel transport. Okay? So we're going to use the same idea. Suppose you've got bi times ai, or b mu times a mu, to stick to our unity. Under parallel transport around a little loop, this is obviously zero. Scalar doesn't change under parallel transport. But zero must be made up of two parts. Zero must be equal to delta b mu times a mu plus b mu times delta a mu. Delta a mu we already know. It's given by this expression. So let's plug that in. So we get that minus delta b mu a mu, okay, is equal to okay, and now we've got this L I business. So let's this is delta A K. K K K K K K minus delta A K times A K is equal to what? Is equal to B, and this now we'll call something else, some K prime, delta A K prime So that's equal to R I K L M A I F, okay, F L M A I by 2. Now, this one was a K. Here we had an I. There's already a K here. What is this K? That is K prime. Okay, so let's make this K. So that allows us to identify delta BK as equal to minus R K K prime L M F L M by 2 A BK prime. Excellent, degrees of land dilutions. Okay, so we've deduced not just how a one form goes over a little loop, but how also a vector changes. Now, we can do this for arbitrary tensors. We can do it like we did in our discussion of parallel transport, by using the fact that any tensor can be built as a sum of outer products of vectors and one forms. Okay? The answer is obvious and is listed in Landau-Lifshitz. I'm going to ask you to check that. It's just the sum of things. Okay, the change of the first times, index by index. Just like it was for parallel transport. Okay, not even going to bother to write it down because it's a big expression. Is this okay? You can look it up in Landau-Lifshitz. Excellent. Fine. So we understand how everything changes under loops of parallel transport. Fine. Now, the next question I'm going to ask is, is there any other important significance of this curvature? And that is, you see, what is the point? The idea is that if you take a vector, you move it parallelly here, 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 you don't come back to yourself. But moving a vector like this has something to do with differentiating a vector covariantly. Because that parallel transport there appears in the definition of the differential in this direction. Whereas moving a vector like this has something to do with differentiating it in this direction. Because differentiating it here involves moving it parallelly in this way. Now, this appears in the derivative that way, whereas this will appear in the derivative the other way, so it's like the inverse derivative. So this loop here has to do with what you will get by differentiating this way and differentiating this way, and then minus the other way around. You see, this way and that way. Okay? So this loop can be thought of as this minus this. And this way is on the x-axis minus then y-axis, and this way is y-axis then x-axis. So just thinking about this in this geometrical way makes it seem like this curvature will have something to do with what you get from the commutator of covariant derivatives. Doing derivative, derivative, minus derivative, derivative. Two different directions. We're going to now try to make that precise. Okay? This I emphasize is important. Ordinary derivatives commute. Del x, del y is same as del y, del x. But covariant derivatives in general do not commute, as we will see, because the covariant derivatives involved with gamma business. Okay? And what are we going to get? So let's just work it out. In one case, we're going to work it out really honestly. And then we'll use, for further calculations, we'll use tricks. Okay, so let's work with the one form. Suppose I look at del alpha of A mu. Well, what was that? This was equal to was equal to d mu of A alpha minus gamma mu theta zeta A zeta sorry? Thank you. D alpha of A mu minus alpha zeta mu. Okay. So now let's compute del beta of del alpha of A mu. What is this quantity? So this quantity by itself is an object with two indices down. So we have to use a formula like this, but with two such terms. Is this clear? So what are we going to get? So I'll write it out in two steps just to be, so that the steps are totally clear. We get del beta of del alpha A mu. Okay? Minus, now let's take the term where the A mu goes along for the right. Okay? So that's minus gamma beta alpha zeta del zeta A mu. And then there's the term where the alpha goes along to the right. So minus del beta of del alpha, let's put the gamma, sorry, gamma beta zeta and this mu del alpha A zeta. Okay, this is what this quantity is. And now painfully we plug in what this is. So once we're going to do it in complete detail, from the next time we'll use some tricks. Okay, so let's plug it in. So that is equal to del beta of del alpha A mu minus gamma alpha mu zeta A zeta. Okay. Minus gamma zeta beta alpha into del zeta A mu minus zeta mu phi. Okay, good. Minus gamma zeta beta mu into del alpha A zeta. So del alpha A zeta minus gamma phi zeta alpha A phi. Painful enough, that's what the expression is. Okay. Now, what we're interested in is looking at this covariant derivative minus the opposite. Right, so this expression that we've written down is this object. What we're interested in is this minus what we get from alpha and beta exchanged. Okay? So let's look at these terms. This term, the term with del beta del alpha, is symmetric. So under interchange will cancel. This term here anything that we get from this whole expression here is also symmetric under beta to alpha, because gamma is symmetric with its low indices. So this object also cancels. Okay, and this term here is also symmetric under beta to alpha. Some dummy variable flip. So that also cancels. So what's so the terms that we have to keep, what remains? So the terms that we have to keep are this. Let me circle the terms we need to keep in orange. This one we need to keep. These we don't need to keep. This one we need to keep. Okay? And both of these nicely have the dummy index for A being zeta. So the terms that we're keeping are minus of del beta gamma zeta alpha mu plus gamma zeta beta mu what happened to my sorry have I messed up on my sorry I messed up on something just a minute what happened to the terms that were
del zeta a alpha
this is del zeta a alpha zeta a alpha. That's right. No, I'm going to need to check that one. And I think I missed up on some. Let me just write what I had before. Del alpha is zeta. Okay, just 1 minute. One minute. Yes. Sorry. So this del beta here, what have I done? I've not kept the del beta acting on A zeta. That's what I've not done. Okay. That's what I've not done. And this is coming with a minus sign. Sorry, people. Just 1 minute. Okay. So in this, of course, there's a term where the... where I'm sorry. I'm getting confused. Just 1 minute. Let me just step back. There's some I've messed up. Okay. So what did we do? Del alpha a mu is del alpha a mu minus this. This is correct. Now we took the covariant derivative of this object. This expression, as far as I can see, is okay. And then we plugged in what this was in each of these. Okay. Now it's certainly true that this cancels. There's no reason that this is symmetric. There's no reason for this to be symmetric. This is certainly symmetric, so that goes, right? The last term was not symmetric. Maybe the last term was not symmetric. Maybe that was my mess-up. Sorry. Let's look at that. So this was, let's look at that. This term was A zeta. I'm sorry. You're absolutely right. This term was not symmetric. You see, it was not symmetric because one of these gammas is special. Because one of them has an index that contracts with the A. Okay, this term minus that term is going to give us the gamma gamma minus gamma gamma in curvature. But now this term and that term should have cancelled. The term that we had with derivative acting on just the E. What's worrying me is that we're getting the same sign. Wait, firstly, is it the right form? So we got a del beta is eta.
No, that will not cancel this one, because we have to write another one. That is del alpha del beta a minus. So the term coming from this, from the other term, which you haven't written, will cancel the term.
You're saying that this will make it symmetric. Huh, that's probably true.
No, this will not make it symmetric, because you have to write another term. This is only del beta del alpha a minus. Then you have to subtract del alpha del beta
in. I understand. So you're saying that the sum should vanish. It will vanish if this is symmetric. If the sum of this and this is symmetric in alpha beta. Let's check that. Thank you. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Sorry. So I've kept the right term, I think. But what I've not kept is this guy acting on this guy. And this guy acting on this guy. Let's check that. So that's what I've not kept is del beta minus of del beta a zeta gamma zeta alpha mu del beta a zeta plus gamma zeta beta mu del alpha a zeta. Okay, it's perfect. As you said, it's symmetric. So under subtracting alpha goes to beta, that kills that. Okay? So, when I circle this, I'll circle it in a cleverer way. I'll circle that, so we'll have the derivative acting only on this. Okay? This part. Again, I uncircle this, but I circle that. Now we're in business. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. So, now we're in business, and so what's our answer? Well, we got the term we wanted was, okay, we might as well subtract beta alpha to beta immediately. So minus del alpha gamma zeta beta mu. Okay, and here we will get minus gamma beta, minus is not there because it's overall outside, minus beta mu zeta. Oh, minus into minus is plus. And I've taken a minus outside, so this is minus. Minus beta mu zeta gamma zeta alpha phi. Now we wanted the index which contracted A to be zeta. There's no phi here, so we'll make that phi up here. The whole thing will multiply A phi. Okay, and then we'll take the other way around. Gamma alpha mu zeta gamma beta zeta phi. Okay. Now this is claimed to be what we should have got is del. Okay, so del beta del alpha of a mu minus del alpha del beta a mu should have been beta del, my cheat sheet, beta is equal to L is equal to beta, K is equal to alpha, mu is equal to I. Okay, should have been equal to AM R. Okay, we'll call it phi. A phi R phi. I is a beta. K is alpha. And sorry, just 1 minute more. L, that's L. L and I is equal to mu. Sorry. IKL. I was mu, K and L were alpha and beta. Okay, so Landau-Lifshitz claims that this should have been our answer. If that's correct, it must be true. This is the answer if this expression here is this. That is, so, and with what sign? With what sign? Oh, with a... Yeah, the way I've written it, with a plus, it should have been. So, if this is right, we should have that R phi mu alpha beta is equal to del alpha R phi beta mu minus del beta phi plus gamma zeta beta alpha gamma phi alpha zeta minus zeta alpha gamma phi beta zeta. Okay, and now I'm going to check the definition and see if this works. One with this index should have first index. Yeah, okay, I'm getting it. I'm getting both terms to the right side. Okay, this is correct. Okay, so we found the right formula. We found the right formula. One of these indices should be mu. Yeah. Oh yeah, there's something wrong with the indices here. How does that go? This term came from here.
First term, beta.
Zeta beta mu. Thank you. Zeta beta. And this term came from here. This is it. It's okay. Right. I checked that. Of course, it's clearly the sum of these two terms and these two terms. I think I checked just now that I got the same signs as Landau-Lifshitz. So we've got. I'll urge you to check this carefully. Okay, you do it right and suddenly come. Okay, excellent. Fine. So we've concluded that the difference in covariant derivatives, difference in the antisymmetric part of two covariant derivatives, acting on an object that transforms, okay, is not zero, but is given by this formula. Okay. This is another way, of course, of seeing that this R is a tensor, because the covariant derivative was built to be a tensor. Difference between two covariant derivatives is also a tensor. A is a tensor, therefore this must be a tensor which transforms in the right way. Is this clear? Excellent. Fine. So now we understand many things about the curvature. Now, this curvature tensor is the basic geometric object that measures how much space-time deviates from flatness. Let's try to understand that statement. Firstly, suppose space-time was flat, then clearly curvature is zero, because it is possible in flat space to choose the usual coordinates, x, y, z, t. All gammas are zero in those coordinates. Therefore, all derivatives of our gammas are zero. Therefore, curvature is zero in that coordinate system. But curvature is a tensor. So if it's zero in one coordinate system, it's zero in every coordinate system. All right? What about the converse? Suppose the curvature is suppose the curvature is 0 everywhere, then is it possible to choose coordinates in that space-time, at least locally, in a local, finite local patch? There could be, you know, identifications. It could be a circle. You could have things that are locally flat but not globally identical to flat space. But ignoring such subtleties, just in a little finite patch, is it possible to choose coordinates? Okay, such that is it possible to choose coordinates such that in that little local patch, the metric is just eta mu nu? Okay, claim yes. Let me give you the proof. Okay, it's a proof that can be given just in words, without any equations, more or less. Okay, look, as we discussed, when curvature is non-zero, it is not possible to take a vector or a one-form at a point and define a vector field or a one-form field by parallel transport, because what you get going to another point depends on the path that you take. However, when curvature is zero, then all parallel transports through different paths gives you the same answer. At least locally, if you don't go through some topological obstruction. Just locally at least, some local patch. Therefore, the procedure of defining a vector or a one-form field by parallel transport away from a point is well defined. Okay? So now let me consider a manifold in which the curvature is zero. At a point, I go to coordinates such that the metric is eta mu nu at that point. So I've got the special point here. I move to coordinates such that the metric is eta mu nu, the second always do. Okay? And in this coordinate system at that point, I look at the one-form field. Let's say a mu is equal to, for instance, 1, 0, 0, 0. 1 in the time direction, 0 in the space directions. Let me start with this guy. I look at the one form at that point. And then I define a one form field by taking this one form and parallelly transporting it all over space. Okay? This gives me a mu, and I'll call this t as a function of x, some one-form field. The t is to remind me that I started with time 0, 0, 0. In a similar manner, I define the one-form fields a mu of x1 as a function of x by parallelly transporting 0, 1, 0, 0. Okay, I define a mu of x2 as a function of x, and a mu of x3 is a function of x. So I've got these nice fields defined all over my neighborhood. Now, I want to set up a coordinate system. Okay? Given any point, okay, I have my special point, which is going to be my origin. Okay? And now, given any point, I associate to this point the coordinates t, x1, x2, x3 as follows. T is equal to integral a mu of t dx mu from 0 to that point. Okay? Similarly, x1 is equal to integral a mu of x1 dx mu from 0 to that point, and so on. Now, some of you are asking, but along what path? Answer, it doesn't matter, because the curvature vanishes. Okay? So this is a well-defined coordinate system. And it's a coordinate system in which these one-form fields, a mu of t is just 1, 0, 0, 0, in this coordinate system, the expression for a mu of t is just 1, 0, 0, 0 everywhere. The reason for that is that 1, 0, 0, 0 dotted with dx mu has the property that that's dt. But our definition of t was that the change in t from one point to another is the integral of a mu of t dotted with dx mu. So putting those two statements together, it follows that a mu t as a field in this coordinate system is the expression 1, 0, 0, 0 everywhere. Okay? Now, similarly, a mu of x1 is 0, 1, 0, 0, and so on. Now, remember that the a mu field was defined by parallel transport. By definition, a vector field defined by parallel transport satisfies the condition that the covariant derivative of this vector field is zero. You see, because the covariant derivative is, take this guy, parallelly transport it back. Suppose I want to define the covariant derivative of a field, what I have to do is to go to some other point, parallel transport this back, and subtract. But, you know, we're just undoing the parallel transport that we did to get here. So we just get zero by taking this. Okay? So this vector field, these one-form fields that I've defined, by definition, are covariantly constant. But in this coordinate system, the derivatives are also constant. Okay? So that tells us that gamma... So let's work it out for this guy for a moment. Okay, so saying is that d mu of a mu t is equal to zero. We know this from construction. Okay? However, d mu of a mu t is equal to d, in, now we work in the special coordinate system, is equal to d mu of a mu of t, but that's zero, plus gamma mu alpha theta a theta. A theta is just the time component. So let's say t. Okay? Since we know that this is zero, that tells us that this is zero. But this argument was true for a mu of t, a mu of x1, a mu of x2, a mu of x3. Tells us that all gammas are zero. Okay? So we've gone to a coordinate system in which all gammas are completely are zero. Okay? And in this coordinate system, it's also true. We probably didn't even need to do this. It's probably even easier. It's probably obviously true that the metric is just eta mu nu. That was probably easy. Be the easiest.
What?
Sorry, say again.
Gammas are sum of the derivatives.
That sum is zero. But if you remember, we got these gammas by okay. Good question. It's a question of symmetry, right? No, you see, we got these gammas by inverting this. Let's do the counting. How many independent gammas are there? Okay, the number of independent gammas are 10 into 4. 10 because symmetric down and 4 up. How many independent derivatives of the metric are there? Okay, 4 into 10 is the 10 components of the metric and 4. And if you remember how we found the expression for gamma, we first had expressions for derivatives of metric written in terms of gamma, and then we inverted those equations. So if gamma has vanished, the derivatives of metric also vanish. Okay. Just the last step to complete the argument. I want to argue that Jasmine, there's one step left to complete this argument, and there's something more direct to say, but anyway, now that we've shown that all gammas are zero, the metric is constant. That follows because okay, and if the metric is constant, we know what it is, because it was eta mu nu at one point, and therefore it's eta mu nu everywhere else. There's probably a more direct way to argue that last statement, but anyway, we've shown that. Okay, so if we have a coordinate system in which, a space-time in which the curvature vanishes at least over an open neighborhood, then we can set up a coordinate system over that open neighborhood in which the metric is just eta mu nu. Okay? So that tells us that curvature, this curvature tensor measures the obstruction for a space-time to be flat, to setting up a coordinate system in space in which the metric is eta mu nu. If the curvature vanishes, space is flat. If space is flat, the curvature vanishes. Okay. Great. So, okay. We've gone slower than I had hoped. Okay. Now, how do you think about the... How useful do you find it for me to do algebra in class? If I... No, it's cheating. Okay, I won't do that. There's some temptation to say it can be shown that we don't want that, right? Okay. No, we don't want that. Fine. So, let's move on. What I'm trying to head towards is building Einstein's action. But we need a few more definitions and a few more things about this curvature tensor. Well, the first property that we want to show there are two things we want to understand, additional things we want to understand about this curvature tensor. The first is the one that Harshan talked about, namely its Bianchi identity. And the second, which we'll actually talk about first, is something that's even more basic, even more elementary, and that is the symmetry properties of the curvature tensor. Let's start talking about that immediately, though we're not going to get very far in this discussion. Let me tell you what the properties are firstly. I'll tell you what, we've got 5 minutes or 3 minutes left. We're not going to finish the discussion of the symmetry of the curvature tensor in this much time. What instead I'm going to do, the proof of the symmetry properties, what instead I'm going to do is I'm just tell you the properties, which we'll prove next time, okay? And then use that to do some counting, which we can do quite simply. Okay, so there are three properties of the curvature tensor that are important and interesting, and don't involve derivatives of the tensor, of this curvature tensor. So we have this R, we have this tensor R, A, B, C, D. Now it's convenient in order to discuss, it makes no sense to talk about symmetry properties between an upper and a lower index. Because that's not coordinate invariant. Upper indices transform differently from lower indices. So if you say there's an interchange symmetry, that can only be true in one special coordinate system. Okay, but it makes sense to talk about symmetry properties of two lower indices. Okay. So the symmetry of this object is maximally revealed when we lower this index as well. So let's lower and look at the object R A B C D. You know what this is in terms of this, right? The metric lowering. Okay. Now the thing we're going to do to start our class off next time is to show that this object R A B C D is anti-symmetric in interchange of C and D. Symmetric in interchange of A and B, but symmetric in interchange of the pair AB with CD. So let's write that down in the equation. R ABCD is equal to minus R BACD is equal to minus R AB BC is equal to R CD AB. And then, of course, by playing around, you can generate more identities. Okay? But the thing to remember is that it's anti-symmetric in its last two indices, anti-symmetric in its first two indices, but symmetric in the interchange of the pair. Okay? And there is one more thing that we're going to prove. There's one more thing that we're going to prove in the next class. And that is that if we freeze one of these indices, let's say we freeze this index A, and then we cyclically permute the BCD index, RABBCD plus RADBC plus RACDB, this is equal to zero. Now this is true for arbitrary indices, arbitrary choices of A, B, C, D. Okay. These three things we will prove in the next class using some algebra. I don't want to start it now because it's stupid to interrupt algebra because you have to start it again next class. Okay. But using these properties, I'm going to ask the following question. I'm going to ask the question, how many independent components are there in the curvature tensor? Okay, so how many independent functions do you have in the curvature tensor? Okay, so firstly, if you ask the question, how many independent functions were there in the metric? The answer to that question was 10, right? 4 into 5 by 2. Okay, now let's try to get, can somebody help me to do the counting? First, ignore this relation. If I ignored this relation, what would the answer be? Not quite. Unless you're in a different dimension. Tell, you want to, we can talk it aloud. Okay, so I'm going to break this question up. How many independent antisymmetric pairs are there? Nine. No. How many independent components in an antisymmetric 4x4 matrix? Six. Six, right? How many ways can you choose two pairs? 4 into 3 by 2. Okay. So there are 6 of these. How many here? So that was why he said 36. But the symmetry between interchange, he's not accounted for that. How do you account for symmetry?
N into N plus 10 plus 1 by 2.
Well, N to N is good. What's the answer?
21.
21. 21. Fantastic. 6 into 7 by 2. The number of elements in a symmetric 6 cross 6 matrix. 6 in a 7 by 2. So that would be 21 elements here. Okay? Now, what cut down do we get from this relationship? That's not so obvious, so let me help you work it out. The first thing is to understand when this relationship gives you something new beyond what you already knew. Okay. So this is true for all choices of indices. Let me see. Suppose I choose B, C, and D all to be the same index. Then I'm claiming that there's no content in this thing. That this is obvious. Why? Because these two are the same index, but it's anti-symmetric in this index. So it's zero. Great. Now, the next thing I'm going to do is to choose B, C, and D to have two indices common. Let's say C and D are the same index. Let's see what I get. The first term is obviously zero, because C and D are the same. Okay, what's the second term? The second term is RAC BC. The third term is RACCB. D is C. Antisymmetry of this and this makes this obvious. So this identity, when any two of the indices of B, C, and D are the same, is not a new identity. Okay? In order to potentially get something we didn't already know, we haven't already accounted for in accounting, we have to choose B, C, and D to be all distinct. Now, let's suppose we choose A equals one of these. Let's say B. Let's see what we get. So we get R, B, B, C, C, D. That's zero. Plus R, B, D, B, C. Plus R, B, C, DB. This is zero, and what can you say about this pair? It's zero. Because this is equal to R, DB, BC is equal to minus R, BD, BC. So this is also automatic. We haven't learned anything new from this new identity that we didn't already know from the symmetry properties. If this A index is one of these three indices. So the only time we learn something new is if all four indices are distinct. How many ways are there of choosing four distinct indices out of a set of four? One. Okay. So the number of independent components in the curvature is therefore 20. 20 minus 1 is 21. Okay, in the problem set which will actually appear soon, okay, we'll give you a problem in which we'll ask you to do this in D dimensions. I'll ask you to do the counting for how many independent components of the curvature tensor there are in D dimensions. Okay? Very good. Excellent. So, the number of components in the curvature tensor is 20. Okay. Now, just to end this lecture, I'm going to just write down Einstein's action. Oh, so there's 2-3 more definitions. Sorry. Okay. We've now got this nice four-index object, R, A, B, C, D. By the way, what order in derivatives? What is the highest derivative of G that appears in the curvature? Second order. Because gamma has a derivative, and there are expressions which are derivative of gamma. So it's a two-derivative term. Okay? That's ideal. In classical mechanics, we like actions with two derivative terms. That's been our experience so far. It's the structure of phase space. Two time derivatives. Position, momentum. Okay? It feeds nicely into quantum mechanics. Okay? So that's sort of ideal. So what we want to do is to take something built out of R and put it into the action. Okay? But you might worry that having two derivative terms in the action is not what we want, that we want one derivative and one derivative square. But you see, the net total number of derivatives in R is never more than two. It's not like you have two derivatives of a metric multiplying one derivative of a metric, which would give you a three derivative term in the equation of motion. I mean, the equation of motion will obviously be a two derivative equation of motion, which is that if you build an action out of R, as we will see in more detail, which is what we want. But, of course, R is not a scalar. So what we want to do is to build some scalar out of R so that we can add it to Einstein's, to the action. Okay? How do we do that? Well, clearly, what we want to do is contract. Now, let's first see, can we get a two-index object by contracting R? Can you think of a way of getting a two-index object by contracting R? Are there many ways? What if I contract A and B? What will I get? Zero. Because it's anti-symmetric. I contract C and D, I get zero. So what are my options? B and C, and which one I choose doesn't matter. So up to a minus sign, they'll all be the same. Okay? So I make another definition. This object, I define the Ricci scale, Ricci tensor. Rik is equal to GLM. R L I M K. Let me make this A and B. R A B G B. Okay. You contract in Landau-Lifshitz conventions. You contract the first and the third index. And you think of this as a function of the second and the fourth indices. Okay. Now, what symmetry properties does this Ricci tensor have?
Symmetric.
Because if I do KA, I'll do... where's my K here? Yeah. I'll do K here, and then this is just a dummy variable. You interchange and... Okay? So, this Ricci tensor is the unique two-index tensor you can get out of by contracting indices in the Riemann tensor, and is a symmetric tensor in its indices. How many independent components in Ricci? There are no further identities for Ricci. How many independent components?
10.
4 into 5 by 2. Excellent. Now, out of this two-index object,